Hello and welcome to today's lecture on deep learning. So today we will revisit supervised learning. However, we will go beyond regression and classification, but look at more complicated scenarios or other scenarios where supervised learning can apply. So where we can use these training data sets consisting of input and output pairs to learn a function. Now, to start, let's revisit the models that we already know. So we talked already about regression, and particularly we mentioned linear regression, where, remember, a input variable x is related to a continuous output y by a linear function f. So if this is f and f is linear, then it's parameterized by a bias. And a slope, w, that tells us something about if we move in x, how much we have to go basically up in y. The other scenario that we have looked at is classification. Remember, in classification, we're taking inputs. For example, here we have a two-dimensional input consisting of x1 and x2, and we're predicting the class label, where the class label is either the blue class or the red class. And these are separated by a line. Yeah? And so the line means that this is linear. And the particular model that we look here is the logistic regression. So logistic regression is very similar to the linear regression. Again, we have a bias, B, and a weight in terms of notation. This realize that B here is a scalar and W is a vector, because it also works on a vector X. So here, if you look, we actually have two input variables, yeah? And they are the individual components of X. So we have our X1 and X2. And W, thus, is basically also two-dimensional, so it's one weight per input dimension. And realize that the output of this calculation is continuous. So it's a value between something between minus infinity to plus infinity. However, what we want to do here is to predict a class label. Now, logistic regression uses a trick, in that it basically takes this continuous x times w and it squashes it through a sigmoid function. So we use this sign sigma here to denote a sigmoid function. What the sigmoid function does, it basically squashes this to a number between 0 and 1 and with this S-curved function. And this function denotes the probability of class 1. So it's a probability of belonging to, in this case, the red class. And by symmetry, the probability of belonging to the blue class would be 1 minus that. And the value 0.5, where the two probabilities are the same, is exactly where this line would go. So everything on this side of the line has a probability larger than 0.5, and everything on this side has a probability smaller than 0.5. However, this model is still linear. It uses already something that goes beyond the linear regression, but because it basically uses the sigmoid function, but it still does a linear classification. How can we take these linear regression models and classification models and turn them nonlinear? And one trick to do so, in order to get to a nonlinear model, I will show you very quickly. It's actually extremely simple. And that is by the use of basis functions. And for example, we use the sigmoid that we've already seen, and we basically use many of them. And they're just placed at different points on sort of the on this line here. And we first take our value x. So these are our input features. And we apply this all these sigmoid functions to it to get some function phi of x, where phi is the sigmoid. And because the sigmoid is a nonlinear function, actually phi of x will be nonlinear. So this is a model that can model nonlinear functions. And the outcome of this, actually, the result of this is again a vector. So if x is a vector and we have many of these functions, then phi of x will also be a vector. And now if we take this and again multiply it by a weight, we get a nonlinear function in x. And then we can add some bias to it and do solve a regression problem. And this regression problem can already be nonlinear. And it is done by first using this basis function, and in this case the basis function is the sigmoid that we already have seen before, apply it to x and then multiplying it by a weight and adding a bias. Now there are also other forms of basis functions, for example these bell curves here, and they are called radial basis functions. The idea is extremely similar and the principle is the same. So this is a way to take linear regression and make it nonlinear. And the same thing you could also do for logistic regression, because you could basically now take the same thing, the whole thing, and say, well, p of class 1 equals, again, sigmoid of b plus w phi of x. And then you would have something that corresponds to a class probability. And what we have done right now is basically we have put a function into another function, and one function was linear and the other one was nonlinear. And this is exactly the trick that neural networks do. They basically iteratively apply nonlinearities to functions, multiply a weight, then get something nonlinear out, and so on and so forth, until they in the end predict an output. And that can be used to get a nonlinear classification and nonlinear regression in a very straightforward way. And a lot of this lecture will be about these neural networks. And the most sort of simple nonlinear or deep neural network is the multilayer perceptron, which is basically always a sort of a cascade of basically doing b plus x times a weight, apply some nonlinearity to it, for example the sigma here, then taking the output of that and again multiply it by some weight, add a bias, so if this is, let's call this 1, this 2, can apply the nonlinearity, and so on and so forth, and by that you basically build arbitrarily complex nonlinear functions. And this is almost the whole trick behind deep learning. Now, we will also in this lecture look at deep learning models. So remember, deep learning models are always sort of these hierarchies of these simple, relatively simple linear model, linear functions plugged into in nonlinearity, and then again plugged into a linear function, and so on, in layers. But there are sort of tricks to arrange the parameters in special ways that allow us to use a lot of structures in input features. For example, if you think about an image, and an image really is just a big matrix of continuous values. For example, here you have grayscale values. And in principle, you could do you could treat them in with a feed-forward neural network by just taking all of these values in this image, for example, this grayscale value here and this one here and all the others as well, and put them into your feature vector x. And then you you plug them into your linear regression model or your basis function regression model or your a multi-layer perceptron, and that allows you then to do a regression with it or a classification, right? Analogous to what we have done before. However, in images, basically pixels that are neighboring to each other are highly correlated, and sort of local patterns really have a meaning. For example, if we look in this area here, we basically see parts of the spine. If we look in, into areas here, you basically see the ribs, but also the shade here, for example, of the heart, and here the lung. So patterns and images tend to be sort of locally clustered, and convolutional neural networks use this local structure. Yeah? And that allows them to build much more potent models than feed-forward neural networks that can be trained much much better by structuring the parameters and actually doing a trick that tremendously reduces the number of parameters compared to a comparable feed-forward neural network. And what can you do with this? Well, you can do classification, you can do regression. For example, we could do classification whether this X-ray image here is a pneumonia or not. A problem that in the current corona crisis or other applications. Well, let's say we have trained our favorite model on images and we show it this image. And well, you may say, okay, let's do classification and classify this as a cat. Let's look at the next image, and we have trained out a very accurate model, and it again classifies it, this time as a dog. Again, well, this is clearly a cat. Now, what if I show you this? So what you already see is that it's hard. Yeah, of course you could classify this as a cat, you could also classify this as a dog, but in reality you wouldn't want to choose. In standard classification, the way we have done it so far, sort of in multi-class classification, you have to always choose a single class, but obviously this can be very ambiguous, and in this case it's not just ambiguous there, but this actually would have multiple classes. So what you would rather want to do is you want to assign it a cat and a dog, but also a rooster and a donkey, right? And maybe even say where they are. But let's say you just assign all of these classes, and that's what we call multi-label classification, because each class that we assign is a label to this image, and we can assign as many labels as we want. So this was the first case where we saw that we can do more complicated tasks than just multi-class classification. This here is another example, this time from, again, from the medical domain. Say we have we are interested in sort of seeing how much blood can be pumped through the heart. So we want to study the heart function, and we do so by using an MRI machine that basically in slices goes through the heart and takes images, right? And so this is basically a single plane through the heart, and it gives us an image like that. And then we do it for the neighboring plane and for the neighboring plane and for the neighboring plane. And Then someone goes about and gives us labels. And the labels are basically these circles here. And what the circles mark are the heart ventricles. And if we know the size of the heart ventricles, then we know how much blood can be pumped through it. And here, well, these are again, all of these are images. So if we learn the model for all of these images that can predict sort of this circle, then we would be able to compute sort of the volume of this heart ventricle. And we already said that these convolutional neural networks are very good models for images, because they apply these tricks and look for these neighboring patterns. And here, obviously, there are very strong local patterns, for example, these edges and sort of this very strong gradient from dark to white, very bright pixels here. However, the output of this is not a class label. However, the output of this prediction is again an image, but it's a binary image. It's basically an image where at every position of the original image, where in the original image we saw the grayscale values, we would get a binary classification. So whether the pixel is part of the ventricle, it would be one, and everything else would be zero or background. Yeah? So we want to go from an image to image, and there are special neural network or convolutional architectures that allow us to do so, and they're so-called fully convolutional neural networks. And we will also get to know them in this lecture. There are also other very interesting things. So images are basically grids of values. You can also think about sequences, so 1D elements, 1D structures. For example, if you think about a sentence, Tom has dinner in Washington with Sally, that's a sequence, so it's a one-dimensional structure. And with the sequences, you can do a lot. So, and of course, sequences language is a big thing. For example, we can take the sentence and look for all the words that correspond to a named entity, and that's called named entity recognition. And it's a problem of basically tagging these named entities. So it's a tagging problem. So we want to see this one is named, and this one is named, and predict them as entity. And we will learn basically neural networks that are very, very well suited for these sequence models and can do this. Or look at this sequence. This is actually sort of an audio signal. Yeah? It's a very sort of, if you look at the sampling rate, they're basically, these features are very close together. And the label that you would like to predict, for example, is, say I tell you this is speech, or you want to even detect whether it's speech, and then say what the words are. And turns out, an output for this would be deep learning. Again, this is not a class label, but it is again a sequence. So it's a sequence-to-sequence prediction problem. And this is basically called speech recognition, going from an audio signal to the spoken word, to the words. But of course, you can also go the other way around, which is called text-to-speech. So basically, given this as an input, you want to generate a sequence that looks like this. Now the interesting thing is that basically this sequence is much higher dimensional than this one. And another interesting sequence-to-sequence problem is, for example, machine translation. And it is a bit particular. Say I give you this sentence in German. Haben Sie sich schon dieses großartige Lehrwerk angeschaut? And the English translation as a label. Did you already check out this excellent tutorial? So this is again a supervised learning problem. We have an input and output sequence. Yeah, so two sequences. Now, the problem is, or why is this in some sense harder than speech recognition? Basically, in speech recognition, so if the order of the sequence always never changes. Basically, this is probably the D, this is the E, and so on. However, if you look at languages, then some languages basically change sort of the order of the words. For example, here we have the verb in the back in German, and here we have the verb sort of in the middle of the sentence. And if you just did sort of a very naive translation of every word, then you may, for example, create a sentence that in English doesn't make any sense and doesn't parse. So you would like to produce a sentence that also passes as a proper English sentence, which requires you to reorder the sequence in the appropriate way. So we looked at a range of supervised learning problems that were input-output pairs, starting with linear models for classification, regression, showing ways how to take these simple models and make them nonlinear by using these very simple nonlinear functions, or by layering multiple sort of linear functions with these simple transformations such as the sigmoid to get the multi-layer perceptron. We did this in a regression setting, but also in a classification setting. For classification, we looked at single class versus multi-class versus multi-label. We looked at tagging problems, sequence prediction, so going from a sequence to another sequence. We said that we can predict segmentation masks as labels for images, where basically this is again an image, however it's sort of binary, or it's a classification on the pixel level. And with this, I want to conclude for today, and see you next time in our next lecture on deep learning, where we will discuss unsupervised learning and some other machine learning scenarios different from supervised and unsupervised learning.